song for our conference this year, the Bourbon Heart, and that song was Hearts on Fire, so that was very good. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to the house of our God. It's good to see you all out today. Let me ask you a question here. If anyone is here for the first time, would you raise your hand for me if you're here for the first time? God bless you all. And can you introduce who was with you, Emily?
Yes, this is my friend, Judy Lynn, and her husband, Daryl Lynn.
Hey, look, I'm going to write that down for you. That's Judy. And I'm sorry, you picked your name?
Harold.
Hey, what I'm going to write is
Daryl.
Say it again.
Daryl.
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 Daryl. I don't think anybody in this room is going to forget your name. Oh, well, we're really glad you're here. We're glad you're here. And, you know, this is really I think it's an important service, although I think they're all important, but it is significant for us all because this is the last Sunday of the year 2013.
Amen.
And you all know that we are prepared to have our New Year's Eve service here Tuesday night at 8 o'clock, and I hope most of you, if not all of you, have received the New Year's Eve letter. We didn't mail them all out this year, but we do have extra copies in the foyer. We have one in that acrylic holder there. And the theme of the New Year 2014 is True Victory. True Victory. And you know it's based out of Matthew 12:20, where the Lord God himself said, I have chosen his son, Jesus Christ, and it said that he would not harm the broken reed, he would not snuff out the smoldering wick, but he's going to bring justice and victory to all. And the theme for 2014 is not victory for me, and not victory for you, because it ain't true victory, Pastor Phil, unless it's, yeah, you got it, it's victory for all. Oh, amen. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So today, if you look in your bulletins, the title of today's message is A Look Back. A Look Back. And when I was considering the title, A Look Back, you know, so often in Scripture, there are references where we are admonished and encouraged not to look back. Does anybody in the room remember Lot's wife? Matter of fact, in Genesis, and I think even the New Testament, it says just that. It says, remember Lot's wife. Does anybody know what happened to Lot's wife when she looked back? She turned into a pillar of salt. Yeah. So don't look back in that regard. I'm reminded of the passage in the Gospel of Matthew where I believe the Lord Jesus Christ himself said, he who sets his hand to the plow is not worthy of the kingdom if he looks back. And I believe that looking back is in reference to not to look back in the year 2013 and not to look back in your life over the things that you have lost. Do not look back at what you have lost. And I think we even elaborated this on a Wednesday because whatever in your past you think you have lost, the Lord has said to me and you clearly, you have lost nothing but everything you have given as a sacrifice to God. Amen. Nothing was lost. Whatever you think was lost was given. It was given from God through you. Any of you ever give a sacrifice to God that you needed God to help you give that sacrifice? Like he informed you later, Robert, hey, by the way, we gave that sacrifice. So we don't look back at what we lost. Never look back at what you lost. Because anything back there was given as a sacrifice. And Scripture says, whatever it may have been, Scripture, I love Scripture, it says it was a sweet smelling savor to your Lord. So nothing lost, but there was some sacrifices. Can I get a witness in the house?
Amen.
Yeah. Weep, but yeah. But you know, there is a looking back that the Lord tells us to do. And another word for look back might be remember. Remember, Brother Randy. Remember. Another word might be, Sister Janet, I looked this up. Flashback. Where are you, Sister Levon? Flashback. And it's so fitting, you know, the theme of the Christmas play was memories. But to look back is to remember. So as we do that, I want you to open your Bibles if you have them. We'll open up to Luke chapter 2. Because I am going to look back to our Christmas Eve service, to what Pastor Phil preached, and I'm going to preach again. I'm going to launch from there. So Luke chapter 2, if you remember, I really enjoyed our Christmas Eve message, and of course, the fellowship and the candlelight. Wasn't that beautiful?
Amen.
I love the candlelight service. It was good. It was well attended this year. It was good. But the message was memorable for most of us. And the passage started in Luke chapter 2, I believe. Pastor Phil, you started in verse 8. If not, we're going to start in verse 8. And he said, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified." But then the angel quickly said, as he says to you and me so often, what does he say? "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. But I was taken by the message of the watchful shepherds, and they watched their flocks by night." And it was interesting how we were told that many, many Israelites that night, they had a roof over them and they had a bed to sleep in, but Jesus didn't, but neither did the shepherds, because the shepherds were out in the field and they stayed up all night. And there was a picture drawn to the great shepherd. I like how you said it to many shepherds, but there was the great shepherd. And the great shepherd of us all, your shepherd and my shepherd, you know his name. He is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Come on now, you out there? His name is Jesus Christ. And you know, I just recently read an article in regard to those who still tend sheep in other countries, perhaps Peter here as well, where, you know, you and I might look out and come across a shepherd taking care of their flock. And if I look at a flock of sheep, I just see a flock of sheep. Whether I see one or whether I see many, it's the same to me. I don't see any difference. I don't know if any of you have encountered something like that. You might see a herd of cattle, or what I would refer to sheep. But if I see a flock of sheep, I just see sheep. A bunch of sheep. Might see wool. If they've just been trimmed, I see a sickly looking sheep. But I just see sheep. But the beautiful thing is this. The shepherd doesn't just see sheep. And what you say, he knows them all one by one. The shepherd knows the one that has the black eye, perhaps. He calls him George. The shepherd knows the one that has the left ear that sinks a little bit. He calls him Rich. The shepherd knows the one that walks with a limp. Bobby, for now, he calls him Bobby. But the shepherd knows every one of them. He calls them by name, I'm sure. And that's why at the end of the day, if one is missing, he knows one is missing, because he doesn't just see a flock of sheep. He sees individuals.
Yes,
amen. Uh-huh. So when one is lost, he says, "Where's George? Has anyone seen George?" And I would say, "George? Are you kidding?" Yeah. Yeah. And that's how God is with us. I know sometimes that you can look into a crowd, and I can look into a crowd, and we can see lots of faces. But the Lord Jesus Christ will always look into a crowd, and he knows you all by name. He knows your name, and he calls your name. Now I, or my brother, or father, or brother, at times we might just see a group of people, but the Lord Jesus Christ always knows your personal name. And Daryl, he calls your name. And he says, "Daryl, I want you in church today because I love you, and I want you to bless the people here, and you have blessed us." Jude. My mother's name is Jude. You see, the shepherd knows the sheep by name. And when they're not here, he calls their names. he goes after the one. And he calls their name. He says, Mary Jo, I see you. He calls their name. He says, Felicia, I see you. He says, Natalie, John. And he knows all of your family names who you cry out for. He says, I know all of their names. And even last night as I was praying, and I'm sure you might, if you don't say the words, I know you have the groan inside of you when you come to the end of another year and you say, another year. Anybody say something like that? Like, I don't know where you go from there, but another year. And I thought, I hoped, I believed, I wanted, I desired. And some of them came through. Anybody? Yeah. Some of them seemingly not. But God knows your name. He cares. He says, Brandy, I've called your name. He knows your name. Every one of you. Every one of you. So even at the beginning of the year 2013, when God calls in the year 2013, I want to take a look back at 2013, and I want to look at some of the events in history and associate it with what God is doing in your life and my life, what he's doing in the world. The first thing God did in January 21st, there was a second inauguration of President Obama. The first thing that I see in the year 2013 was the inauguration of the president. And what I see also is this, that God ordained the year 2013. God ordained the year, and he ordained exactly what he was going to do with your life from January 1st to December 31st. Nothing has failed him. You are right on target. Everything is going according to plan. Does anybody want to say amen?
Amen.
Oh, okay, that's great. That's great. Nothing is lost. You hear me? Nothing is lost. Nothing is lost. Your life is right on target. He's got every day and every moment. He calls you every morning. The only reason why you get out of your bed in the morning is he calls your name. And then if it's a pretty name like Donna Summers, he calls your name. Donna Summers. So the first thing is the inauguration. He ordains your life. He said when you were going to be born, Michael, and why you were going to be born, and what purpose you have, Marty. He calls you by name. Zinga. So everything that happened in 2013 is not a failed year. It's a God's year, because God said, I ordained the year, and I ordained every breath that you breathe. Can I get another witness? Give me some help, or I'll just go for a few more minutes. Yeah. And as I looked through the year, I wanted to see some of the other highlights of the year. And one of the other things that I saw, as a matter of fact, was something that happened in 2013 that has not happened for 800 years. Something happened in 2013 that has not happened for 800 years. Anybody want to venture a guess? I'm going to look smart because I have the answers in front of me. Bobby? Pope. The Pope.
Thanksgiving and Hanukkah happened at the same time, right?
That's not on my sheet. But the first time in 800 years, the Pope abdicated his position. He retired. You know, usually the Pope died, right? This one retired. And you know the name of the new Pope? He took on the name Pope Francis. He is Pope Francis the First. Pope Francis the First. And you know he took the name after Francis of Assisi. And I just find that beautiful because do you remember how we started out here in 2013? We read the quote from Francis of Assisi. And you know his motto, what he lived by this. He lived by helping the poor. He lived by living for the greater good. He lived by denying the earthly pleasures and take care of those around you. And you know, and this is what this Pope did. And one of the things that Pope Francis I did was this. He says that doctrine is not important. Doctrine is not important. Brotherly love is important. Brotherly love. And I believe that's what God is doing in the earth. He says this. So many times, come on now, so many times we have been divided over doctrine. Strongly divided, and we always believe that we were the ones that were right. Can I get a witness? Yeah, of course. We believe that we were the right ones. And isn't it interesting? Anybody who does not believe is wrong, right? Well, you're not saying right for me, but you say right for yourself. We believe that anyone that didn't believe like us is wrong. Because we were the center of the universe. But you see, what St. Francis says, and Francis of Assisi says this, doctrine is not what holds us together. Because doctrine is truly what divides us. Isn't it interesting? You can have a family knit together by love, torn apart by doctrine. Amen. Doctrine. By what you believe. Oh, I believe this, I believe that. Oh, then we're separated. And I believe God's doing something new in the earth today where he said, no, that will no longer separate you. Doctrine and teaching and what you believe will no longer separate you from everybody around you. And we used to think it did, and it was supposed to. We used to think that we were fighting the cause of God. Oh, let everybody hate me. I don't care. That's not true. You better care. And the Lord says, brotherly love is what's important. Brotherly love. And, you know, even with that spirit of the fervent heart, you know, we had our conference, and I think that was the biggest thing that happened in New Image Ministries for quite some time. And the fervent heart, as we went into that, we discovered the heart of the Father. And we discovered all of the fire that the Scripture talks about, all of the fire of God, is not a picture of the wrath and anger of God. We always thought fire was anger. There was fire in his eyes. There's the lake of fire. He's going to burn his enemies with fire. And we thought fire was a picture of the anger of God and the wrath of God. And until we discovered the fervent heart, and we discovered fire wasn't a picture of anger. Fire was a picture of love. It was a picture of passion, burning, white, hot, burning passion. I believe that God opened up our eyes and my eyes where I will never, ever, ever, somebody be with me, ever be the same again. I am serious. Is anybody with me? I will never be the same again. I no longer see the fire of God as an angry God. I no longer see him hurting people or passing their judgments to bring harm, but I see the fire of God, the lake that you see in Revelation, the fire that you see in his eyes, is his passionate love that he has for humanity, for all of his children. Amen. And when he says he's going to get you with fire, that means he's going to consume you with his passion. Who? Everybody. Nobody. Nobody escapes the passion of God. Amen. Amen. And then we saw that if you mix the fire of God with the word of God, you'll never get this thing wrong. We will never get this thing wrong. We have taught from this book for over 2,000 years, and you get 1,000 different translations, a million different translations. And it brings division, right? And it brings damnation and condemnation to the world. It brings judgment. And the Lord says, okay, now, believe it or not, in the third day, because we're living in the third day, he says, I'm going to add some fire to it all. I'm going to add my love to this. And when you add the fire of God to the word of God, when you add the complete, pure, passionate love of God to this word of God, you will never, never hurt anyone again. Amen. If you add the complete love of God to this passage, you will never get it wrong. Amen. Never get it wrong. Scripture says the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. Sometimes we think we're walking in holy anger. I don't think so. I don't think I've seen holy anger yet. I've seen a lot of anger. Anybody with me? Hey, hey. I haven't seen much holy anger, quite honestly. Although we've professed it. I am righteously angry with you. Thank you. That's the biggest thing that has happened in my life to this day. Fire of God is the love of God. And unless we take this word and mix it with the absolute pure love of God, we will never get it right. Amen. Amen. The fervent heart. And then what I saw also, so the events in history, I saw the inauguration of President Obama. I saw the new priesthood. There has to be a new priesthood. And the new priesthood was St. Francis, and the new priesthood says this. He says equality to all. Do you hear about some of the things that St. Francis did on his beginning week in office? I believe he was on his way somewhere. Maybe, let's say he was on the way to the Vatican. Did you see this one? He stopped into the hotel and he paid his bill. You saw the Pope at the counter pulling out his wallet. I didn't even know the Pope's had a wallet. What a beautiful picture. And when he went to Brazil, he had a group of youth around the table, and before he blessed the youth, he asked the youth to first bless him. One of the other acts he did, it was one of the holy days, and on one of the holy days, he decided to wash the feet. He washed the feet of two women, and one of them was a Muslim woman. No pope has ever washed the feet of a woman before, nonetheless a Muslim woman. For those of us who still see division, there is no division. When President Obama was inaugurated on January 21st, 2013, he put his hands on two Bibles. He put his hands on the Bible that belonged to Abraham Lincoln, but there was a little Bible on top of it, and you know which one was it? It was the Bible of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. He put his hands on two Bibles. And he says, there's no division, there's no black, no white. Uh-huh. And President Obama was the living, breathing fulfillment of the dream that Martin Luther King talked about. I had a dream. And President Obama lives the dream. 2013. And then in the midst of all that, what I saw, I don't have all the dates in front of me. Some of you might know the dates. I think it was April, June, July, maybe July, where there was the royal birth. Anybody hear about the royal birth? Did you get the memo? Does anybody remember the name of the baby? Prince George. Prince George. There was a royal birth. And I do believe that. 2013, there was a royal birth. Listen to me. God has birthed something new in your life and my life. I know it to be true. Is anybody else who's curious? I know it to be true. When we no longer live for ourselves, we're no longer building our own houses, but we're building the house of the Father. Where we're no longer living a life unto ourselves, but we're living a life unto who we are. Where the me gets lost in the we, and the I gets lost in the us. Anybody at all? And I believe that God, not only did he change the priesthood, but he gave, there was a royal birthing inside of you, man. Like Christ himself. Yeah, the scripture is something like Christ in you, the hope of glory. There's a Christ in you that was given birth that sees this world as God sees this world. Come on now. There needs to be a people on this earth that truly sees the world as God sees the world. You see, God looks upon the world and he's not crying and he's not angry. He looks upon the world and he loves the world. I'm going to give you some scripture. For God so loved the world. And he said, while you were at your worst, I gave you my best. He says, while you were lost in sin, I died for you. What makes us think he's angry now? He already took care of the worst of it. Yeah. He already took care of the worst. When the world was the darkest, he sent his son to die for us. What do you think he's going to do next? Love you. Love you. He already died for you. What about the fire? Didn't you hear? The fire is the love of God. And when the love of God, that lake of fire, gets a hold of you, it's going to burn away all your sorrow, all your enemies. You want to call your enemy the devil, Satan, the false prophet, the beast, death, don't, whatever you want, hell. I've experienced all of them. Anyone else? Let's look back. I've experienced some death and some hell. I've experienced the false prophet. I've experienced some of that stuff. And that's what the lake of fire, the pure passion, the love of God is going to go into your life. It's going to destroy your hell. It's going to destroy the death in your life. It's going to destroy the false prophets. It's going to destroy Satan, the beast. Anybody tired of that beast? Now, don't be pointing fingers. I hope a name did not come to your mind. Ooh, I am tired of the beast. Don't be looking in the mirror either. It is the pure passion of God that will destroy these things. When I stop judging you and I start loving you, these things will be destroyed. And then we can call down the fire of God as the disciples of Jesus called down. Call down the fire of God. Call down the fire. Call down the love of God. Call down the passion. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So there is a royal birth. I believe there's a new life to be lived. For everyone in this room, there's a new life to be lived. There's a new life to be lived. And I want to end with one of the last things that happened. Not the last things, but the one that's in my mind was the passing of Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela, December 5th. And you know what Nelson Mandela is known for and how he put an end to the divisions in his continent. And at his memorial, it says at his memorial service, there were, some say there were 91 world leaders.
Wow.
91. The most ever in recent history. 91 world leaders. It was the biggest event that ever happened in the continent of Africa. And I like what they said, because they said amongst the dignitaries, and there were many of them, they said the dignitaries were there, and the street sweepers were there. The high and the low, bringing equality to all. And you and I, we need to look back, we need to look into our world, and don't see death and destruction. Does anybody see God?
Yes.
Does anybody see God?
Yes.
In the events of history?
Of course.
Whether they believe what I believe or you believe or not, as if we have all the right answers. Does anybody see God? And I see how God has looked over the earth since the beginning of time. And he has looked on his children and humanity with absolute love. And he has ordained every moment, every person who would rise, and every person who would fall. And I believe we've come to a place in this earth where God is calling us all to a unity, to a love for our brothers and sisters. That we are all the children of God. What's going to happen in the end? Love. Love. What's going to happen in the end? Will fire consume the earth? Open your eyes, it is. It is. This earth will melt with fervent heat. And yet the elements of there. I'm not talking about the trees and the mountains and the rocks. What about this? This world has melted with fervent heat. Where you and I have given birth to a new world, a new belief, and a new understanding. And the absolute love of God. A shepherd who watches over their sheep, his sheep, and knows them all by name. And what Pastor Phil said is true. He says, not one, not one, not one will be lost. And as we go into the year 2014, the title of 2014 is True Victory. And we've said this and we'll say it again. True victory is this. True victory is not when I have victory and you don't. It's not when you have victory and your neighbor doesn't. That's not true victory. True victory is when we all have it. When we all have it. Amen. So how do we all get it? Why don't you make sure your neighbor gets it? Why don't you build the house of the Father? Go after the one. Go give them some victory. Amen? I'm going to ask the worship team if they'll come forward. Sister Trick, Tiger Lou, Carlos, Brother Randy. You got this off hand anytime, 10,000 reasons. And you know, even as I was praying in regard to the end of the year, you and I might look back at the year and we might have the same kind of prayer. We might have the same prayer where it says, I don't want 2013 to pass though. It's like, if you think that something significant did not happen in your life in the year 2013, I believe the Lord calls you by name and he does not want it to pass unless something significant happens to you. 2013. And this is what I want, and I believe it's what you want too. There is something or some things in my life and your life that I do not want to bring into 2014. I can name a couple. Maybe you can name a couple. But maybe it's just one thing. Maybe it's just one thing that you would ask God, that you would pray to God and cry to God and say, God, I have prayed for this for so long. And I would pray with all my heart, and I would join you with your heart's cry and say, I don't want to bring this to 2014. I prayed the prayer a million times before, pray. But I say, Lord, I've got one thing, by the way, just one thing. Just one thing. I say, Lord, this one thing. Can you give me this one thing? When I look back at 2013, I want to look at this one thing, and I want to say this, because I love you, Lord Jesus. I want to say, and look back and say, that thing never came into 2014. Let 2013 be known as the year that this thing ended in my life. And whatever that might be, and I can cry out for you all, and say that there are things not only in my life, but in our life, body, family, there's things in our life I don't want in 2014, and you don't want in 2014. Things that hurt the body and the family. And I cry to God and I say, Lord, can you give us one thing? So before 2013 ends, and before we walk into 2014, if you have one thing, you don't have to name it but you got it. And say, God, I want this not to come into 14. I want to look back at 13 and say, this is the year that this left my life. I want you to run up here and stand with me because I have something. Come on. Come on. With your Lord, you can speak or think, meditate in your heart. Just spend some time with God. Everybody in the front, talk with your heart. With your heart, talk with your heart. Tell them, Jesus, I love you. Oh, Jesus, this is my prayer. This has always been my prayer. I pray for all of us. This has always been my prayer. When you say, what do you want? I've always said, Lord, I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. Therefore, we lift our voice as one and we say, this one thing, I say this one thing. Will you give me this one thing, Lord, because I love you? I don't want this in 2014. I want to look back at 2013 and say, this is the year that this left my life.